Good afternoon. I'm Professor Roy Gardner with Stetson's Institute for Biodiversity Law and Policy, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this year's final Edward and Bonnie Forman Biodiversity Lecture. And also welcome to those of you who are joining us via the webcast. As you know, the purpose of this lecture series is to foster a dialogue among students, academics, attorneys, policymakers, environmental scientists, and other stakeholders. The lecture series is made possible through the generous support of Bonnie Forman, who is a member of the College of Law's Board of Overseers and the university's Board of Trustees. Bonnie is just a great friend, and we so much appreciate all that she does for Stetson. Although Bonnie could not be with us today, we are recording this for her, so please join me in thanking Bonnie Forman. Thank you so much, Bonnie. And this is actually her favorite biodiversity lecture of the year. Because before I introduce today's speaker, I want to welcome the students and coaches participating in the Stetson International Environmental Moot Court Competition. This is the 21st year of the event, and we are hosting the international finals over the course of the next 3 days. Teams have competed in regional rounds all throughout the world to be here. So actually, if we could go around the room, and if you are with a team, if you could please just stand up and one of you say which country you're from. Is there a mic? Yeah, there we go. So, here we go.
Hi, we are from India. We are a team representing Symbiosis Law School, and we all are undergraduate law students.
Great, thank wonderful. You. Welcome.
Hi guys, we are from National Taiwan University, and we are composed of graduate students and undergrads.
Thank you. Welcome.
Hello everyone, we are from Nepal, and we study in Kathmandu School of Law, undergrads.
Hi, my name is Martina. We represent the Irish team and the Law Society of Ireland. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Let me come up around that way.
Others? Anyone over here? No? Teams?
Hello, from University of St. La Salle. Representing Philippines.
Hi, hello, good afternoon. We're from the Philippines representing the Cagayan State University College of Law.
Other teams?
Hi, we're from Brazil and we're representing the Federal University of Bahia.
Wonderful, wonderful. It's great that you could join us, and I know that you all have a special interest in today's speaker, who will also be a judge in the championship round on Saturday afternoon. It's a real honor to introduce Judge Anthony Luckey. Born in Trinidad and Tobago, he left at the tender age of 18 to study law at Gray's Inn in London. He's had an incredible legal career, locally, regionally, and internationally. He's worked in the private sector as in-house counsel of the Royal Bank of Trinidad and Tobago. He has served in the judiciary in Trinidad and Tobago as a magistrate, as a judge of the Supreme Court, and as a justice of appeal in the Court of Appeal of Trinidad and Tobago. In 2003, Judge Lucky was elected a member of the United Nations International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, or ITLOS, which, as this audience well knows, is the judicial tribunal for the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. He was re-elected in 2011. States that are parties to UNCLOS are the actual voters, and he received 142 out of a possible 149 votes at UN headquarters in New York. Judge Lucky has served as president of two of the six chambers of ITLOS, most significantly for our event this week, as president of the Chamber for Marine Environment Disputes from 2005 and then again from 2011 to 2014. And since 2014, he has been president of the Chamber for Fisheries Disputes. We were speaking yesterday with the judge and his wife, Cintra, and we're so delighted that you could join us as well, about connections, about how we have different connections throughout the world. And so actually, here's one more. In 1997, my friend and colleague from the Ramsar Convention, Dave Pritchard, studied the implementation of the Ramsar Convention, a wetland treaty, in Trinidad and Tobago. And in his report, he described Trinidad and Tobago as a lesson in proactivity that many countries could learn from. He wrote of the enthusiasm and the courageousness displayed in conserving wetlands. And he noted that a key step in protecting one site, a wetland of international importance known as Navira Swamp, was the eviction of illegal large-scale commercial rice farmers. And Judge Lucky ordered their eviction, declaring that the fauna and flora of Navira Swamp must be protected in the public interest. Effective environmental protection requires an interdisciplinary approach and broad-based community support. But sometimes it demands judicial action, especially when short-term and short-sighted political and commercial pressures seek to override the public interest and damage the environment that provides benefits to people now and to future generations. We're so delighted that Judge Lucky is with us today to hear his thoughts about the role of courts, domestic and international, in protecting biodiversity. Please give a warm welcome to Judge Lucky.
Thank you very much, Professor Gardner. In fact, at one time I wondered, is it I he's talking about? And when you all introduced yourselves around the tables, I thought to myself, there's not only biodiversity being talked about here, it's diversity from all these countries that you represent here today. And there are several countries, for example, I heard from the Philippines at ITLOS, we are involved in a matter with the Philippines. From India, we are involved with the matter with India and Bangladesh. From Bangladesh, we did the case with Bangladesh and Myanmar. And so we see diversity here, which is such a good thing. So I wish those of you who are taking part in the MOOT all the best. Let me begin by saying that it's a profound honor to have been invited to deliver the final Edward and Bonnie Foreman Biodiversity Lecture of this spring semester. My concern and interest in this topic stems from the fact that biodiversity is very important to all of us. This opportunity is welcome more so because of my participation in the national and international judicial system. In this lecture, I will share my experience and views in the hope that these will inspire you to further discussion on the protection of the marine environment and, of course, the impact of biodiversity. If the environment could speak, would it express satisfaction with the performance of those who are meant to guard its interest? It's a question for you to consider. If the environment could speak, would it express satisfaction with the performance of those who are meant to guard its interest? In any event, whenever the performance ratings given to the executive and the legislative branches of government, how would the environment judge the judiciary? In my opinion, the most important criteria is the success of judges to equate the protection of the environment and biodiversity conservation to that of a fundamental right with swift and accessible avenues to the court. The question of whether judges are doing enough to develop jurisprudence and interpret laws is relevant to all judges who sit in courts, panels, or tribunals, determining matters in which environmental issues arise. I sit, as you've heard, as a judge on the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, which is mandated to, amongst other things, protect the environment. And I have often asked myself, how far am I allowed to go as judge when confronted with competing rights of states in which there are hotly contested environmental impacts? Such a situation occurred in a case in which I sat, and there was great diversity in the approach that was taken by the ITLOS tribunal. In the particular matter, the expert from one state said that there was significant damage to the waters caused by the reclamation work conducted by the other party. The expert for that other party testified that there was no damage being caused to marine life or any pollution or blockage of the waters forming the subject matter of the complaint, which was actually in the Straits of Johor between Singapore and Malaysia. After hearing evidence in the matter, the judges of the tribunal were not unanimous in their decision. The majority ruled that there should be discussion and cooperation among states, and cooperation between the states involved to address the concerns of the party alleging marine destruction, while the minority decisions indicated that the reclamation work should cease on a stayed or permanent basis. I will get back to that case in the course of this lecture as I see some smiling because they know I was one of the dissenting judges. You see, damage to the environment is irreparable, and time is always of the essence. Diplomatic approaches to save the environment, while laudable, do not allow the restoration of permanent damage. I have witnessed in my country the closure of visits to the famous Buku Reef in Tobago, because for decades, tourists were allowed to walk freely on the coral and break off pieces of the reef as memorable keepsakes. Now, while the need for industrial development is appreciated, so too must there be consideration to the environment and environmental costs when such activity is undertaken. Again, I draw reference to smelter projects and highways in Trinidad and Tobago, which were put on hold because of real fears that the environment and biodiversity would be severely affected. The question I pose about how far judges are expected to go is not of recent vintage. It goes back as far as the Industrial Revolution, where the courts were confronted with similar issues, that is, private rights versus public interest concerns. In that time of manufacturing and mass production, judges appeared unwilling to budge from their comfort zones of being strict interpreters of the law. Thus, threats to the environment were of little concern to the courts. It was the right of the individual that had to prevail at that time. The words of Vice Chancellor Sir William Page Wood best expressed this rigid question when he stated, without apology, in 1858, in the case of Attorney General versus Birmingham Corporation, and I quote, he said, "It appears to me that as far as this court is concerned, it is a matter of almost absolute indifference whether the decision will affect a population of 25,000 or a single individual carrying on a manufactory for his own benefit. The rights of the plaintiff, Mr. Adderley, must be measured precisely as they've been left by the legislature." He went on to say, "I am not sitting here as a committee for public safety, armed with arbitrary power to prevent what it is said will be a great injury, not to Birmingham only, but to the whole of England. That is not my function. My function is only to interpret what the legislature, the proper body to which all such arguments should be addressed, has considered necessary for the town of Birmingham. The town of Birmingham is to have neither more nor less than the legislature has thought necessary for its protection. The plaintiff's rights are neither more nor less than what the legislature has thought to leave him," unquote. But what if the strict application of laws or the unyielding adherence to principles of law results in a decision that is detrimental to the interest of the environment? I put this question to you. Is there some supreme body of law that enables a judge to widen the vision of judicial blinkers to include environmental concerns of public magnitude? In the introduction to the United Nations Environmental Program, the UNEP Judicial Handbook on Environmental Law, published in 2005, Sri Lankan judge Christopher G. Weeramuthi said, and I quote, "The judiciary is moreover one of the most valued and respected institutions in all societies. The tone it sets through the tenor of its decisions influences societal attitudes and reactions towards the matter in question. This is all the more so in a new and rapidly developing area. Judicial decisions and attitudes can also play a great part in influencing society's perception of the environmental danger and of the resources available to society with which to contain it," end of quote. I now turn to a very important matter, the constitutions of nations. And I think all of you here from all the countries know how important the constitution of a country is. Many nations have recognized the need to address protection and preservation of the environment and have included provisions in their constitutions to reflect this commitment. Modern constitutions versus traditionally framed documents recognize that the environment needs protection and that the citizens must play a major part in preservation of the environment and biodiversity conservation. By way of example, the Guyana Constitution places an onus on the state and its citizens in separate provisions to preserve the environment. In the preamble to the Constitution, all citizens undertake to, quote, "demonstrate our commitment to protect our natural environment and endowment." And Section 21 states, "Every citizen has a duty to participate in activities designated to improve the environment and protect the health of the nation." And Section 36 of that Constitution states, in the interests of the present and future generations, the state will protect and make rational use of its land, mineral and water resources, as well as its fauna and flora, and will take appropriate measures to conserve and improve the environment, unquote. The advantage of such responsibilities articulated in unequivocal language better equips the court to make its decisions with full disclosure that environmental concerns will be on front burner considerations. I accept that the use of the phrases rational use and appropriate measures, as they appear in Section 36, lack specificity. But in my view, and rightly so, such phrases enable a court to assess each matter on a case-by-case basis and to have before it comprehensive and thorough reports from experts in the fields of environmental study to assist the court in its determination. By doing so, it encourages citizens to become more aware of environmental issues and impacts and forces environmental agencies to ensure that their investigations and findings comply with the tenets of integrity and accuracy. And while constitutions provide protection for the environment, so have the domestic laws. I'm certain that in all your countries, there are domestic laws to protect the environment. And you heard Professor Gardner say earlier, speak of the Ramsar Convention and the fact that it is incorporated in the wetlands you saw earlier on the screen and in the river swamp. And we thank, and I did privately thank Professor Gardner for his contribution that he made for the protection of our river swamp. And further, for the laws, and he didn't say it, but I presume he was influential in the laws, domestic laws that were passed for protection of the river swamp, making it a restricted area. So usually, we speak of man versus the environment, or man and the environment. But has the time come for man to realize that he is part of the environment and not just one of many species in a community alive with biodiversity? You see, by changing the physical optic to show humans as part of, rather than apart from, the environment, it immediately widens the scope of rights for those who act on behalf of the environment, and the courts take on a much larger and more prominent role in its protection. The view was best expressed by Justice Portia Alino Humacherelos. The Philippines will correct my pronunciation. A Filipino judge, an academic scholar, who wrote in an article entitled, If Cases Are Filed, The Role of the Judiciary in Biodiversity Conservation. And I quote, because our world has become so complex and we have been made aware that there are so many other denizens in our planet Earth with which we humans interrelate, interact, and are interdependent upon, our laws now take into account all other creatures of this world, not just human beings. Our laws reflect the reality that as living things, we are part of a web of dependency that makes up the environment. We humans are not separate from the environment, but are part of it. And more compelling is the fact that if we destroy the environment, we destroy ourselves as well. Hence, in relation to the environment, we see the role of the courts as guardians of the law in civil, criminal, and administrative proceedings, to the end that the courts are or become instruments in protecting society's interest, in safeguarding human health, and in protecting the natural environment for the present and for the future generations, unquote. The onus is therefore on the courts to ensure that its machinery is well oiled and its tools sufficiently sharpened to play its role in the promotion of biodiversity. I now turn to the rule of law. Earlier in my presentation, I referred to the role of judges and the need for judges to be mindful of the importance of biodiversity and the protection of the environment in their decisions. Some jurists have argued that such an approach will encourage judicial bias in favor of the environment, and judges are meant to be impartial at all times. Other scholars have been quick to point out that reading and interpreting laws with the protection of the environment being of paramount importance displays a full appreciation of the need to ensure mankind's survival. Put bluntly, it is a means of ensuring that the court protects man from destroying himself. By depleting and exploiting the resources upon which he depends for his own survival. So taking the two scenarios I have just discussed, which would you prefer? Courts that have underplayed the merit of environmental concerns in their decisions, or courts that have ruled to preserve mankind? The choice is yours. Any discussion on the role of the courts in the promotion of biodiversity must include reference to the rule of law. The rule of law is based on the principle that all people and institutions are subject to and accountable to law that is fairly applied and enforced. When dealing with the interpretation of laws, judges traditionally had a more rigid approach to the decision-making process. Judges of the past ignored policy and applied a literal interpretation of statute and legislation. For example, Lord Diplock of the United Kingdom was an advocate for the literal meaning of instruments. He said the following, and I quote, "Absence of clarity is destructive of the rule of law." The term rule of law includes the principle, as Joseph Raz puts it, that all laws should be prospective, open, and clear. Its meaning must be clear. An ambiguous, vague, obscure, or imprecise law is likely to mislead or confuse at least some of those who desire to be guided by it. End of quote. I disagree entirely with Raz, who saw the rule of law concept as only one of formalism. He was concerned with form rather than content. That is just my view. Lord Bingham, also of the UK, created 8 principles for the rule of law. The first 4 are as follows. The law must be accessible and, so far as possible, intelligible, clear, and predictable. Questions of legal right and liability should ordinarily be resolved by application of the law and not the exercise of discretion. Laws of the land should apply equally to all, save to the extent that objective differences justify differentiation. And law must afford adequate protection of fundamental human rights. I agree with the substantive elements as enunciated by Lord Bingham. And I also commend Lord Denning, who became popular, some might say controversial, for giving consideration to aspects other than what was expressly stated in statutory instruments. I am an admirer of Lord Denning, and some of you who may read some of my separate and dissenting opinions might say, look, he's trying to be like Denning. I think it's a good try, most of us should. In applying the rule of law principle, how far can judges go in instances when the environment or biodiversity is at risk? I commend the view expressed by Professor Del Antwine. a distinguished Caribbean scholar and jurist, who in a paper entitled The Rule of Law versus Rules of Law in the Quest of Development, in which she stated, and I quote, "Are judges to hold their hands up in despair, powerless and subservient to executive power, even in the face of ignoring the will of the people? Will that be the rule of law? Caribbean peoples expect their law, legal systems, and if that fails, their judges to protect them in their developmental aspirations. They do not expect the judge's role to be frustrated because of too narrow construction of what the rule of law means. In my view, our constitutions already include within them these foundational values for true development. In what can be described as the second phase of constitutional forming, some countries like Belize, Guyana, are highlighting these core values clearly in their constitutions. Consequently, reading law in barren ways to exclude these deep values, assumptions, and aspirations that live in our law, sometimes deeply embedded, sometimes springing to the surface, does our law and our people a great injustice. In truth, it is a self-constructed prison. Our constitutions and our laws are meant to be much more. The restrictive Collymore approach, which saw our constitutions as little more than codifying common law rights, is obsolete and no longer acceptable, given the dynamic jurisprudence that is occurring and is needed." End of quote. I mentioned the name Collymore. I just like to let you know what we called the Collymore approach. Mr. Collymore belonged to one of the big trade unions, an oil field trade union. And a law was passed, of course, called the Industrial Stabilization Act to prevent strikes in Trinidad and Tobago. And Mr. Collymore, and you can imagine, sitting like just as you are, happily in his office, and in walks an officer of the law into his office demanding certain documents. And Mr. Collymore took the matter to the court, saying that his fundamental right of freedom was infringed. I think that's our Section 4 of the Constitution. And his right to privacy was infringed. And the matter went to the court, and the first instance judge decided against him and said that the statute was supreme. The Court of Appeal agreed with the first instance judge, and the matter went to the Privy Council, and the Privy Council said yes, in those circumstances, the statute remains as it is, and Mr. Collymore didn't have the right. I'm happy to let you know that very soon after, we got the Industrial Relations Act. That old act was totally discarded, and now Mr. Collymore can carry on his union business in peace and quiet without any public officer walking into an office. It just goes to show you that how the progression of the law causes the legislation to think again. Professor Rosemary Bell Antwine further stated in her paper, and I quote, "Law, even the Constitution, does not and cannot always give us ready-made answers. So it is left up to the jurist to discern from the elemental values and norms that underpin the law and our democracy if the judicial system is to have legitimacy and meaning." End of quote. I agree wholeheartedly with Professor Bell Antwine. I'd now like to give you a quick study of a Jamaica case. Most of you know Jamaica. Several of you have been to the North Coast, to Ocho Rios, and to other cities on the north. And this was a case of the Northern Jamaican Conservation Association and others, and versus the Natural Resources Conservation Authority and others. This was a matter that came before the judge. Now, those of you who have gone to Montego Bay, and those of you who have seen Runaway Bay and all those lovely beaches, the facts are as follows. along the northern coastline of Jamaica, there's a bit of land nestled by the sea, which is rich in biodiversity. It is known as Pear Tree Bottom. Dale Weber, a marine biologist, said that in his expert opinion that the ecological value of Pear Tree Bottom area is very high and the ecological resources are important. He spoke of the fringing reef. He added that few areas along the north coast display that sort of biometry and diversity of corals, fish, invertebrates, and associated benthic flora. The applicants sought judicial review of the decision to grant a permit given to Hotels Jamaica Pinero Limited, short HOJAPI, to build a hotel. The permit was an environmental permit, and without it, development at Pear Tree Bottom would quite likely not take place. The applicants raised the issue on whether the respondents made a decision that was unreasonable, and no decision maker could have made it. This immediately introduced what is now referred to as Wensbury unreasonableness. You young people would like this. At that time in 1948 in the United Kingdom, and the case is known as Picture Houses versus Wensbury Corporation, it was decided that on Sundays, I repeat, on Sundays, movie theaters should not open. And further, if they opened, no child under the age of 16 should be allowed to attend the movie theater. And there were objections. Well, you could imagine here in Stetson, young people want to go to a cinema and you have somebody under 16 and they say, no, today is Sunday, you can't. To use the words of my grandson, they would freak out. In fact, I think even some of you, having heard that on a Sunday in this particular case, you couldn't go to the movies, you couldn't go and see La La Land or any of the others, you would be very unhappy. Anyway, Lord Green went on to speak of unreasonableness in a more narrow and specific sense. In this narrow sense, the successful challenger must prove, that's in Wensbury, something overwhelming. So in this Jamaica case, Justice Sykes explained that it was not enough to assert that the decision maker made an unreasonable decision. The decision must be so unreasonable that it must be irrational. Shall I repeat that? The decision must be so unreasonable that it is irrational. So Justice Sykes asked the question, what of broad Wensbury? Let us give a broad interpretation. He stated that since Lord Green spoke, the courts have developed techniques that can be prayed in aid to circumvent the narrow Wensbury approach, such as a doctrine which you all know, the doctrine of legitimate expectation. So Justice Sykes further stated, and I quote, we are now at the stage where it is safe to say that the intensity or stringency of the review varies according to the importance of the subject matter. Human rights issues, therefore, attract a very stringent review with lesser rights. I am not devaluing their significance, attracting a lower level of stringency. He went on to say, it would seem to me that environmental legislation ought to attract a fairly high level of scrutiny. The consequence of bad environmental management can be disastrous and in some cases fatal. Those of us who have lived in this region where hurricanes travel with great and increasing frequency have seen the damage that can be wrought. Wensbury unreasonableness does not assist much in this kind of refinement. He then went on to discuss the question of consultation, which in most countries, as in your country, there is a lot of consultation on certain matters that concern the whole population. I'm a judge, not a politician, so I stay clear, very clear. I'm dealing with the law and the law alone. The respondent in this case did have a duty to consult the public. Hojapai submitted an application for a permit to the National Resources Conservation Society, NRCA, who decided that an environmental impact assessment, and you deal a lot of it here, EIA, was needed. The EIA was circulated to a number of government agencies for their comments and recommendations, and the EIA was then disseminated to the public for their comments. The applicants submitted to the EIA that the EIA had many fundamental errors, and no reasonable decision maker could rely on it. For instance, it was common ground that a marine ecological report that should have formed part of the EIA was not submitted at the time the EIA was sent to the NRCA. The marine ecology report was also missing at the time of the public meeting. In fact, the public, other than perhaps the applicants, still do not know of the marine ecology report. No one knows what effect it might have had on the public discussion. Sykes-J determined that the omission was significant. The area under consideration was agreed to be an area that is an ecologically important one. It is located where two rivers enter the sea. There are mangroves that filter the fresh water that runs into the sea, and that helps to balance the salinity of the sea so that marine life suitable to the environment can flourish. The area provides a home for migratory birds, while the beach offers a home to turtles to lay their eggs. The virtues of the ecosystem in the area have been extolled by many. It has been said that no other wetland of equivalent size and with the same mix of physical and vegetation characteristics has been described as on this coast. Justice Sykes also considered Hojapai would have engaged architects, engineers, contractors, laborers, goods, and materials. He cited Lord Walker in the Belize Alliance of Conservation Non-Governmental Organizations versus the Department of the Environment in Belize Electric Company Limited. And he said, the rule of law must not be sacrificed to foreign investment, however desirable it may be. Indeed, recent history shows that in many parts of the world, respect for the rule of law is an incentive, and disrespect for the rule of law can be a severe deterrent to foreign investment. The people of Belize are entitled to be properly informed about any proposals for alterations in the dam design before the project is approved and before work continues on its construction. That's the construction of a dam there. So Jay found, as we say, Justice Sykes, the consultation process was flawed because an important part of the EIA was not placed in the public domain and the public was not told about this omission. Now this case demonstrates that traditional narrow Wensbury is not very helpful when the complaint is that the decision was arrived at by a flawed process. Had the court been restricted to the application of narrow Wensbury, the NRCA and NEPA might well have escaped unscathed. Narrow Wensbury, while not dead, has been mortally wounded. And a lot of people would be happy about that, especially moviegoers. Administrative law has moved on, and we should embrace the views of Lord Wolfe, Cook, Slynn, and Stein, who have taken us to the door of proportionality. Let us open the door to see the dawning of a new day, unquote, from the judgment. So the use of such eloquent language by Justice Sykes reinforces the point that in law, in this case, the Wensbury test had to be given its widest application in order to recognize the importance of environmental rights and concerns. I read this case, and you could forgive me for spending some time on it. I read it with great excitement because it showed that Caribbean jurisprudence was embracing the fundamentals of the expanding role of the judge in matters involving the preservation of the environment and biodiversity conservation. Only later did I learn by way of a newspaper article written by Petrie Williams of the Sunday Observer, that Justice Sykes, 1 week later, reversed his order due to a procedural error not caused by the hotel builders. And although construction therefore proceeded, one of the litigants who brought the action against Hojapai was quoted in an article as saying, quote, "I think we have established some very strong building blocks in environmental jurisprudence, and we will see how we can build on them," unquote. So this is a case I am going to leave with Professor, the whole case with Professor Gardner for your library, so in due course you can read the eloquence, the beauty of the language which we are going to hear in the moots between today and tomorrow. I now turn to a case that Professor mentioned, the famous Jabbar case involving these wetlands that were shown earlier on the screen. While sitting as a High Court judge in Trinidad and Tobago, I ruled in a case cited as Jabbar and Jabbar versus the Minister of Agriculture, Lands and Fisheries and the Attorney General as defendants. The plaintiffs were planting rice in the vicinity of the Nariva Swamp, which is the largest wetland as well as the largest freshwater swamp in Trinidad. However, they began to encroach onto the wetlands and did so with heavy equipment, intruded into the swamp area, which had been declared as a protected area as per the influence of the Ramsar Convention. And I see that his cheeks are turning red, but I'm going to do it anyway. The influence of Professor Gardner, and obviously indirectly from Stetson. So they began to encroach on the wetlands with this heavy equipment, intruding into the swamp area that had been declared a protected area. In other words, they were trespassing. They claimed they had been given licenses to farm. The defendants submitted that not only were the plaintiffs trespassers, they were also endangering the natural environment and flouting the law. Several experts testified, and after considering the evidence, I found that the ecosystem was endangered and the delicate balance in the swamp's biodiversity was threatened. I therefore ordered that the farmers be evicted. At page 82 of that decision, I stated, and I quote, "Our constitution is the supreme law of the land. It is not a social document. It provides for good government and good order through adherence to its provisions and the law made in accordance with its provisions. It will not permit disorder or a chaotic situation whereby persons can break the law with impunity or simply caress the limbs of the Constitution by going onto state lands, cultivating same, or building houses on same, or having done so, seek constitutional relief," unquote. The arguments submitted on behalf of the plaintiffs included that they were farmers, and they were making a valuable contribution to the stable diet of the nation, rice. In fact, you know, when you are sitting in court, and some of you will be judges, the judges are usually high up, and you hear comments, sotto voce, vote sotto voce, which the judge is not supposed to hear. So when I was giving this ruling in this particular case, one of the judges said, "Sotto voce is sound enough for me to hear. I hope he does not eat rice." So apart from the diet, they went on to say that the economic value superseded the ecological system. It was further argued that it was their constitutional right to gain a livelihood. I did not accept the argument because the court could not condone the making of a livelihood by illegal means. And although I did not pose the question to myself back then in 1993, because it did not arise on the facts, I do so now and I pose the question. What if the plaintiffs, that's the Jabbars, were not squatters and they were on the land legally, but their farming activity was causing damage to the environment and destroying biodiversity? what would be my decision. This would call for a determination of competing constitutional rights and the need to protect the environment. I would have had to consider all the matters I have raised in this presentation and the development of jurisprudence and environmental law. So if that was the factual scenario, I ask again, how would I rule? Or how would you rule? I leave it there. You guessed it right. The farmers would be evicted because the environmental concerns would be paramount. I don't think anybody in Stetson would disagree with that. Of course, I would have had to hear expert testimony on the matter and ensure some kind of compensation for the farmers. And of course, my decision would be appealed, as it was in the Jabbar case. It was appealed, but the Court of Appeal held that the judge was right. But the only way to develop the jurisprudence in protecting the environment and conserving biodiversity is by pushing the law to its legitimate purposive end. And before I end, I would just like to refer to the land reclamation case, Malaysia versus Singapore. You remember that early in my presentation, I referred to a case involving land reclamation and the testimony of conflicting experts. In the matter, Malaysia claimed that provisional measures, this is very similar to injunctive measures in the municipal courts, that these were necessary to preserve its rights relating to the preservation of the marine and coastal environment and the land reclamation being conducted by Singapore, especially in the Pelau Tekong area, should cease. Now you would see on this map here, all the areas in red were the areas that were being reclaimed. And the expert evidence was, and the evidence in that case, was that in Singapore they needed to reclaim land because there was evidence that children needed places to play. They needed more and more land. But then up at the top, you would see Malaysia to the top of the map, Singapore below, and the areas in red. And they claimed that the reclamation was causing the currents in the Straits of Johor not to flow. As a result, the mangrove was being affected. And the mangrove being affected, it was not filtering the fresh water into the sea. And the whole ecological balance and the whole system and the ecosystem was not being properly balanced because of all the crustaceans and so that fish would feed upon. So all of that was led. The majority of the tribunal ordered that the parties should seek expert advice on whether the land reclamation would affect the marine environment. The majority did not think that Singapore should cease reclamation and referred the matter on the merits to an arbitral tribunal, on the merits to decide, well, in whose favor. The majority opined that it was the duty of the parties to negotiate and to cooperate. Two judges ruled otherwise. One judge in a dissenting ruling decided that the appropriate measure was to order the appropriate measure in the order was to protect the rights of Malaysia, and he would prescribe the suspension of infilling works in Area D at Pelau Tekong, pending the results of a scientific study by both parties. I was the second dissenting judge, and I found that the evidence disclosed the real possibility of serious harm to the environment, and that Singapore should cease its reclamation activity with immediate effect. I did not agree with what, in my view, was the majority of the tribunal's diplomatic approach to solve a major environmental disaster by diplomatic means. So, I still was accepted when we went to Singapore. They didn't throw me out. But this was the approach I took, that the protection of the environment was more important. And so, in conclusion, and as I conclude this presentation, I ask the question for all of us to consider. are the courts responding fast enough and developing the law on the environment in sufficient time to save the planet on which we live and from where we get all our resources? If it is about survival, then the courts must ensure that environmental rights are not trampled upon or treated with scant regard. Boosting economic activity and approving programs and projects for national development cannot be viewed in isolation. Judges have to appreciate the underlying principles of the rule of law and the overriding duty to protect mankind, even from himself or herself. Perhaps the time has come for judges in all matters in which there is a real need or a real need. Perhaps the time has come for judges in all matters in which there is a real or apparent environmental impact to call for reports from experts to speak on the issue. The public must also play its role in ensuring that decisions that will affect the environment and biodiversity are the subject of informed public consultation. The right to life and not to be deprived thereof, except by due process of law, which is enshrined in most, if not all, constitutions, may have to be read as a right to each individual to protect himself or herself from the acts of others which will destroy the environment or biodiversity. Whichever approach or action is taken, of one thing we can be sure: it is the courts that must fulfill their mandate to protect the world for this generation and the generations to come. Thank you all very much for your kind attention. It is appreciated, and I sincerely hope that what I have said would create further discussion and would be a contribution to this hallowed institution, Stetson. So once again, thank you all very, very much.
Thank you very much, Judge Lucky, for those very thoughtful remarks. And I know that I have a number of questions, but I want to let our audience ask questions. And those of you who have a class and have to leave for, go ahead, please go. But for those that don't have a class, if you have a question, please raise your hand and I'll come around with the microphone. This is, of course, your opportunity to ask the judge questions, as he will be asking you questions later in the week.
Judge Lucky, has the ITLOS, have they encountered any case that climate change and the issues associated with climate change have been brought before the court?
So that, of course, is something we're going to be talking about shortly, but.
Thank you very much. That's a very good question. At the moment, in the terms in which you mentioned the question, no case has been brought before us directly involving climate change. But indirectly, I would say yes. In the case of the Arctic Sunrise, Netherlands versus Russia, I think you all would know about it, where they went towards a Russian platform and they were going to put up a banner. But when they saw them coming along in a tube that looked like a torpedo, so they said in the evidence, the Russian Navy came and arrested everybody and housed them in the nearest prison. But the question here was this: Greenpeace was putting forward to them that because of climate change and what is occurring in the Arctic, by doing what they were doing, they were affecting the system. So the court did not go, per se, into climate change because Russia refused to appear before the court. So it was done in absentia, in their absence. And they focus more on the release of all the crew of the Arctic Circle that were put in the Russian prison. So it was just touched upon. And there are other cases where, for example, climate change did come up in our case of Bangladesh versus Myanmar. Because an island in the Bay of Bengal, because of climate change and rising sea levels, disappeared. And when we were fixing the boundary, I'm glad you raised it, when we were fixing the boundary, yes, you will see in the judgment that climate change was referred to and that we have to exercise caution. And that's the way that we put it at that time. Thank you very much for the question.
Thank you. I saw a number of people taking notes on that. Yes. Other questions?
Judge Lucky, you just said in before that people are the part of environment, and yet in the case in Trinidad, where you agreed that the farmers, squatters have to be evicted, the environment took the paramount place. Why do you think then the biodiversity was more important than people who were part of the environment?
Yes, Khadija, one second. Are you referring to the Jabbar case, are you?
Yes, sorry, maybe I didn't hear it right.
Yes, no, that, I just wanted to get that clear. In 1993, yes, I held that the protection of the environment and the biodiversity was more important, because scientific evidence was led from Professor Kenny, well known at the university, and others, who said specifically that the biodiversity in the swamp was being affected, because the Nariva swamp, I'd just like to let you know, it would help you, is 3.5 feet below sea level. So the runoff water after rain only goes out when the tides are low, and is protected by a sandbar on the beach. So in those circumstances, I held that although they claimed that they were gaining a livelihood and they were supplying rice to the country, the environment was more important, because if they didn't look futuristically, if they destroyed the flora and fauna and the swamp and the salt water came in, then it would even get to where they were rice farming. So all these factors came into consideration. And I'm glad you raised this question, because the decision has been criticized by several, including university students, one in particular, who wrote her thesis and pointed out that the judge should have gone in and obtained more scientific evidence and more from the experts before just simply throwing out the people. But these are all matters for consideration, and that's why I posed the question towards the end. If I sat on that case today, or if it was a case in Guyana, what would have been my approach? And if you don't mind, I think you can consider it from that aspect, and that's why I posed the question. It's a very good question. Thank you very much.
All right, I'll take the last question then, and sort of a two-part question. One is, do you have any advice to law students as they go through their education and how they should prepare themselves if they're looking to be a judge? And also, what opportunities are there for students to participate in the proceedings or learn more about the proceedings of ITLOS?
To answer the first is, in preparing yourselves for the future, especially here in the United States, there are many decisions that have been given by your Supreme Court on the interpretation of the Constitution. Because law is English and grammar. and you must equip yourselves for the interpretation of the law, the construction, the interpretation, construction, and application. And for all law students, this means studying the rules relating to interpretation and the rules set down by the courts. The second question is, and I have been asked to raise this here, at the Tribunal for the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, during the year and every year, they put out brochures, and I have given, I think, Erin some for you to see. They have given out brochures where you can apply to the court, to the tribunal, and they allocate scholarships known as Nippon Scholars, because it's funded by the Nippon Foundation of Japan. And these students interact with the judges because they are all preparing papers for presentation at the end of their 9 months. And during that time, they get the feeling, and they some cases come on and they see how we operate. The other is that I have been asked by the tribunal, and this is official, I've been asked to let Professor Gardner and the powers that be here know that Stetson should be in touch with us, because during a case, the judges need judicial assistance, what we call a judicial assistance officer. Sorry? Yes. Sort of like what you call the clerks here, or clerks, as you say, in the system. So I use the English way, clerk and clerk, but it means the same thing. A rose by any other name is still a rose. What happens is that the students would come from Stetson, and they would get, their passage would be paid for. And when they are there, they get a stipend, and sufficient for board and lodge and everything. And the judges then send them and say, could you research this particular point for me? Or could you do some research on this? And they are interacting with the judges, and so you get a relationship. Because Stetson, as I have learned and I am learning every day, it's the Stetson University of Law. And therefore, you should equip yourselves with law in every sphere. And I would like to share this with you. When they were negotiating for the setting up of this court, the main country that advocated strongly for the setting up of the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea is the United States of America. It's just so unfortunate, and it still hurts the older ones of us who were in the PrepCom, that there was a change of government and the United States did not sign the convention. But they are looking once more towards signing that convention. But it is of deep interest to the United States of America, and they sit as observers at all the meetings of states parties. So for the law students, there are openings, it's wide, and if you go onto the net when you are through at Stetson and you get your degrees, you will see that there are advertisements for lawyers at the United Nations and in the institutions which are branches of the UN. Thank you.